was hanging on her every word. They started as Polish soldiers, but then the war ended and they became guerrillas. Guerrillas? I think guerrillas. To fight the Russians' occupation. And then they ended up as desperate bandits, she signed. For the people who lived here, they were like all the same. Germans, Russians, forest soldiers. They killed, they maimed, they tortured and burned villages. It didn't matter what language they spoke. So, what does it have to do with me? Thanks for the history lesson, I said, but where do I fit in into all of this? My great-grandparents were from here, she signed. After the war, there were some changes, and my whole family was sent to Siberia to die. My grandmother was the only one who survived. She met a Buryat shaman, and here I am. But your story is tangled with all of this. She looked straight at me. Have you ever wondered what your grandfather did during the war? I wanted to answer, but suddenly I felt dizzy. The smoke from my joint smelled funny, of forest moss, strange herbs, ash and blood. Let's try to stay focused. I focused and understood the strange feeling came from within. It was like a long forgotten dream, like an ancient memory suddenly brought to life. I let it in. We are sitting around a fire, deep in the bushesa. The others are sleeping. I listen to the whisper of the leaves. The forest is speaking to me, demanding action. It wants me to be its revenge. I understand what has to be done, and I can't wait to be the forest revenge. I make the others and tell them the plan. Tomorrow we're going to burn a village. I sit by the fire and listen to the wolves howling to the moon, weeping for their slain brothers and sisters. And then the vision ends. When I came to my senses, Lisa was looking at me. Let's just think about it a bit. If I understood what you're saying, I looked at her, something from my family's past cast the shadow of my future. She shrugged. I've told you everything I know. If you want more talk, talk to my girlfriend. We'll be at the locking site tomorrow. Yeah, it might be a good idea. So my grandfather was a forest soldier, I already thought so. I will, I said. Now I finally knew who and what to ask. There you are, Bartek waved to me. I thought I lost you. I said my goodbyes to Lisa and we went back. Bison statues were watching me with their creepy painted eyes as though they knew me. Let's go to the village center. This is such a nice village, exclaimed Anya as we walked along the quiet street. Nothing moved, the heat was stifling. It's really quaint. It's quaint, I carefully admitted. That's a nice way of saying it's a shithole, Bartek made a disgusted face as he burst into laughing. I'm thirsty. Let's get something to drink, I proposed. I'm parched. The local store was a large mini-mart with all kinds of goods, from beer and vegetables to notebooks and pens. There was a bench near the entrance. On it were a few local drunks. I prepared myself for a confrontation, but nothing happened. They threw me an appraising glance, murmured something, and let us be. They were creepy. I didn't like the vibe they were giving off. Their eyes were too sunken, their movements too jerky, and strangely coordinated. And they reeked of sweat, wet cellar, as something rotten. Who are they? I whispered to Bartek. Just the local drunks, he shrugged. He spent some time inside, browsing the Latvian, Lithuanian, and Belarusian goods. Why are there almost nothing Polish here? And who in their right mind drinks coriander soda? I was putting the soda back on the shelf when we heard a commotion coming from the outside. Some slurs, some curses, and clear, mockingly polite. I am so sorry, darling. I don't understand. Do you like my skirt? A fork! Bartek murmured under his breath. I looked outside. There was someone standing next to the drunken bench. And they weren't local. This person was old. Not helpless granny old, but old, with deep wrinkles and a narrowed mouth. They had the unisex grace of a tired heroine preserved rockman. Shoulder length, disheveled hair completed the look. They looked out of place. They looked like someone had teleported them here from a different planet. They had clean shave and eyes highlighted with eyeliner. Their nails were painted in bright blue. They wore heavy army boots, an outrageously red skirt, a tank top, lots of leather jewelry. On their back was a pin. Were pins, lots of pins. All kinds of LGBTQA+ flags, anarchists and pacifist symbol, and I think some German band stripes. Yeah, my mom probably told me to stay out of it. Don't get involved, my mom always told me. You keep getting into trouble. You don't want to get into trouble abroad when there's no one to help you. But that was the problem, wasn't it? I always managed to get involved. I couldn't just let it go, even now. Let's approach the foreigner? I smiled, ignoring the men approaching the foreigner. Hi, I'm Maya. I just got here, I said. They looked at me with a serene smile. Nice to meet you, Maya, they said with an unmistakably German accent. I'm Kim. Ah, let's start talking. What brings you here, I asked. In Białowieża, I mean. I came to see the forest, and to protect it. They sounded deadly serious. Me and my friends heard about what's happening here and decided to come and help. The men on the bench were looking at us grimly. Hey, someone said suddenly from behind our backs. Kim smiled, and the men on the bench stiffened. It was Lisa. You should stop drinking that moonshine. It makes you pick fights you can't win, she said. She looked ferocious. She looked ferocious and the drinks started explaining themselves. But look at this, Elzunia? One of them said, gesturing towards us. For the last freaking time, the name's Lisa. She was furious, and this is my friend. You're to leave them alone, got it? The drunkards mumbled and went back to drinking. Thanks, Lisa, Kim said in English. You shouldn't have. Oh, but I wanted to. Why did they listen to you, I asked. She turned to me and shrugged off with a hint of smile. Well, they have their reasons. I think I saw relief in her eyes when she looked at me. Hi, Maya. I was worried you'd gotten yourself into trouble here. So, will you join us on the anti-logging protest tomorrow? She asked after a while. Suddenly, I'm feeling a rush over me. Yeah, let's go. We can ask the girlfriend then. I mean, we need more information about her family, so we have to go there anyway, so we can... during the protest anyway, I suppose. I couldn't see the forest from here, but suddenly I felt aware of his presence. I also felt something else deep in my stomach spreading through my veins. Anger. Like a wave of heat coming from the heart of the dark, ancient forest. A word appeared in my mind. A strange one that was, neither Polish nor English. Bagheera. I felt like I was being watched, and when I looked up, I saw Kim observing me with an anxious... with a curious expression. They were hiding something, probably. I looked at them and realized they were much more than they first seemed. Under their colorful attire lurked something else, something primal. Why are you looking at me like that, I asked. I know you have strange dreams, they whisper. I suspect the force is reaching out to you. They leaned closer to me. It runs in your blood. Those words were like a punch in the gut. Trust me. I know. Who was I? Who am I? I asked quietly. You can see the invincible, they said. Invisible, they said, looking at me in the eyes. You'll find a way. I feel confident. I felt a sudden surge of confidence. Hint, I met someone who knew about my dreams. That's very nice. I wasn't making that up. There was something strange in my family history, and there were people who knew what was going on. Before I could ask more, Anya and Bartek approached and Kim shook their head, silencing me. Meet us tomorrow at the logging site. They blew me a kiss, put their arms around Lisa, and walked away. I have a feeling she might be a girlfriend. Is she? We called it a day and went back. That's probably a good thing. The first evening, the B&B was quaint. I left Anya and Bartek outside. It looked like they needed some time alone to say their goodbyes. When I got out of the shower, Anya was back, smiling and a little flustered. What a day, she smiled. So, what do you think? I made a quick mental inventory of everything that has happened today. So they're either cutting down the forest, the scene of the shop, the graveyard... Let's... mention the graveyard. I think that's the most direct contact we have, or the direct connection we have to our family. What happened here was that people are still vandalizing my family's grave. What did my father do? Well, nothing good, that's for sure, she signed. I remember the burning village in my vision, and I decided not to argue. Let's talk about what happened with Lisa. Something weird happened when I talked with Lisa. I think it was her joint, but I saw some things. It looked like something from my past. Like, from your past? For a second I searched for words to explain it to her, but couldn't really. I think it was my grandpa. It's hard to say, but I'm sure it was weird. I shrugged, ending the topic. They are cutting down the forest. I can't believe they're logging here! I shook my head. Isn't the forest on the UNESCO list or something? Yeah, I know. I wanted to check out this protest people were talking about. Maybe we could go there tomorrow? Remember the shop? The tension almost seemed unnatural. A few words more and it would be a regular fight. Maybe just envied Kim's style. Anya tried to joke. But she seemed worried. Yeah, I don't feel like talking anymore. You know what? I'm seriously tired. Let's call it a day, shall we? Soon, we were both in our beds, ready to sleep. I was tired, sure, but also excited. And excitement isn't the best for sleep. I lay there for a while, thinking about everything that happened and what might happen next. The wind from the open window leapt on my skin as I watched the silver rectangle painting over the wall by the moonlight. When I closed my eyes, I could still see the weird vision I had that day. My roots were here. I could feel them. Almost touched them as they were reaching out to me. I felt I had the answer I was looking for, but within my reach. I just had to go and see the logging protest, meet the right people and make them talk. After a long while, all these thoughts became blurry. They slowly started to turn into pictures, sounds and colors, and I drifted off. Ooh, the night in the woods. A lonely ray of moonlight shines on the broken nameplate of the old grave. Imprisoned, under the cold, shining stone, the dead wait for something. I feel excitement rising deep within my stomach, and then throughout my whole body. I'm a weapon. I'm a razor sharp knife. I'm a sword. I'm a gun waiting to be fired. I'm asleep for now, but soon someone will use me and I can't wait. Damn, the art is beautiful. I feel a pull and I surrender to it. I am pointed towards a clearing. There are piles of fresh corpses of people who died too young, skinned and mutilated. Their loved ones stand around them, grieving, unable to do anything, waiting. As suddenly, there are just trees and trunks. You know, let's look around. So I am even more analytical. I look around, my nostrils flare. Who did it? Who murdered trees? There's a stench in the air, like meat rotting in acid, but somehow worse. I see the monstrous army. The mandibles are whirling chainsaws. The long metal arms are wrapped with black pipes that look like blistering intestines. The smell is vile. They wait, unmoving. Let's turn to the forest for answers. The dead don't hold answers, and neither do the machines. I walk between the trees, trying to hear their wisdom. They whisper to me, telling me to look at the sky. There, between the stars, two shapes circle each other. An old sad wolf with grey hair and a white weasel. They keep their eyes on one another as they continue their dance, suspicious but not hostile. We need to fight the enemy. The awful rotting stench. I know that much. But how can we do that when we don't trust one another? They stop. They look at me in the clearing. But here I can jump towards them. Or I give them my blessing. Let's give them my blessing. I spill my blood and bless them with words that I do not recognize. But then I understand. They come down to me. And the voice is the voice of the Kusetsu. Welcome back. You have been away for too long a time. Now wake up.